ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this series of informal evenings, chambers chats, co-organised by Lo Chiu Wo Law Library and the General Education Unit. I'm your moderator tonight. My name is Tony Lau, a fourth-year government and law student. The General Education has been providing non-credit-bearing programmes to all HKU students in the past 20 years, cultivating among them breadth of knowledge which they can consider themselves as educated individuals of the community. The events of General Education Unit usually take place at auditorium, open spaces at school. In my recollection, this should be the first time we have such meeting at the Law Library, a very special occasion indeed. Looking through the list of participants, I could identify another special feature of this event. That is, we have students from different backgrounds tonight to engage in the dialogue, which includes not only students from the Faculty of Law, but also Faculty of Arts, Social Sciences, Engineering, Medicine, and so on. And it reminds me of Justice Anthony Kennedy of the US, once he said, "Law students go to the library and they begin to study, and we hope they encounter what Holmes called the secret joy of isolated thought." In the Commons, the students discuss the ideas of law, the concept of justice, the meaning of freedom, with students from all disciplines, other backgrounds from other countries, and so it goes, from library to Commons. This is exactly what we are doing tonight. The topic today, the direction in which the law in Hong Kong is moving, is certainly not something solely related to law students, but every one of us. We are honoured tonight to have the Honorary Mr. Justice Bokhary to share his insights on this topic and engage in conversations with us tonight, and Professor Johannes Chan as a facilitator. Justice Bokhary has been a non-permanent judge of the Court of Final Appeal. He was appointed to the High Court in 1989 and elevated to the Court of Appeal in 1993. In 1997, he was further elevated to become one of the founding justices of the Court of Final Appeal. From 1997 to 2012, Justice Bokhary was a permanent judge of the CFA. In addition to his good self, we are very delighted to have his three mascots friends, Crookie, Stinky, and Foxy, with us tonight. I'm sure you would find them very familiar if you have read his last two books, The Law is a Crocodile and Crocodile at Law. On the other hand, every HKU student should be familiar to Professor Johannes Chan as well. Professor Chan is a former Dean of the Faculty of Law. Being the longest serving Dean of the Faculty, he was also a visiting professor to a number of universities in Europe and Asia. He specializes in human rights, constitutional and administrative law, and publishes over 200 publications in these fields with distinguished publishers. Thanks to the charisma of Justice Bokhary and Professor Chan, we have another 50 audience watching live broadcast of this talk inside the small moot court on the 7th floor of this building. Audience there, as well as all of you in front of me, can also submit your questions, but on the 7th floor you can only submit in a written form. I'm sure Justice Bokhary and Professor Chan are happy to respond. Before we kickstart of the event, I would like to invite the University Librarian Mr. Peter Sidoku to present souvenirs to Justice Bokhary and Professor Johannes Chan as a token of thanks. Mr. Sidoku, please.
My principle, then, if you want to make people believe that you deserve something, you hold it out like this.
Johannes, I have some couplings for you. The sentiment, which I think everyone will agree, perhaps you can read out the couplings.
Trust me.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
For our moderator as well, something a little more modest.
And we'd like to also invite, the Director of General Education Unit, the Dean of Student Affairs, Dr. Albert Chow, to present his souvenirs to Justice Bokhary and Professor Johannes Chan as a token of thanks. Switch off your mobile phones or turn it into silent mode. And now I would like to pass the mic to Professor Johannes Chan to kickstart of our event tonight.
Thank you, Tony, for the kind words. And this evening when Mr. Joseph Kari saw me, the first question he asked is, who painted my tie? And I said, a crazy person. And he said, that fits the occasion very well. We have two tonight. I'm asked to say a few words about Mr. Justice Bokhary. This is just Bokhary, needs no introduction. He's a great judge and a good friend of mine. For those of us who know him well, we call him Kemi. And of course, he sits on the Court of Final Appeal. And as a judge, he's always courteous and pleasant. And I have the privilege of appearing before him on quite a number of occasions. And many of those occasions, he's the only judge I managed to persuade. he has that charisma in court that makes you feel very pleasant, even you are arguing a totally outrageous point, and he's still very encouraging and willing to listen. Kemi is sometimes known for his dissenting judgment or separate judgment. That's probably not fair, but on the other hand, of course, dissenting judgment is a great strength of our system. It affirms the independence of the judiciary and the independent mind of judges. And dissent is always dissent on the interpretation or understanding of the law or applications of the law to the particular sets of facts there. And time and again, it has been shown in the history of common law, the dissent judgment of today could well become the orthodox principle of tomorrow. And dissenting judgment sometimes, and from time to time, it simply means the one who makes the dissents just live ahead of his time. And Kemi is also known for his common sense. On the one hand, his judgment is always very learned. On the other hand, he managed to decide a case with the very frontal common sense. And in one leading case on public assembly in Hong Kong, which deals with a few Falun Gong people who were demonstrating on the street, and they were charged with the offence of obstructions. The prosecution was a heavy-built prosecuting counsel, appearing very fearful and frightful in court, and arguing the case that they should be convicted of obstructions. And Kemi put the questions to them, of course, lawful demonstrations will necessarily cause some obstructions in the highway unless you are going to demonstrate at home. And I'm sure probably two elderly ladies and maybe four hunger strikers who is getting thinner and thinner every day is unlikely to occupy a lot of space in the street. Looking at the prosecuting counsel, he added maybe a barrister of an above average size won't cause much space in the street either. And the case collapsed on that point. And one thing I discover about Kemi is in a meeting, I can't remember what meeting it is, but apparently the discussion was so exciting that his mind started drifting away and he is scribbling and I wonder what he was scribbling, and I found that he draw croquis down there, and indeed he is a very accomplished cartoonist. All the cartoons was drawn by him, and he think of all the history, and also these few mascot friends are all made by him. And one of his most proud thing, whenever you came to his chambers in the court, the first thing he show you is a huge crocodile. And through the crocodile, since his retirement, he has found interest and influence in a very different industries, which is the writing of books. And since his retirement, he has finished 4 books by now, which makes us academics ashamed. And when we complain we don't have enough time to write articles, he just produced books. And he managed to express sometimes sophisticated and complicated concepts in just a few lines, sometimes through his best friend, Crocky. In one cartoon, he suggests what is a statement, a man's state of mind. And he said, this man's state of mind is like the state of his digestions. And Crocky replied that that is not rocket science. My state of mind and my state of digestion is always the same thing. And as a friend, Kemi is always warm and generous and humorous, and you can find his humor throughout his writings. And since his retirement, he is less constrained and what he can write. And so you find his comments on almost every front of life. And on one occasion when someone is criticizing or making a comment that the court is making too many laws, and he replied through Cocky, someone has to make law. After all, the Legislative Council these days seems to be too busy trying cases. So, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, let's welcome Mr. Justice Bokhary.
Thank you, Tony. Thank you, Johannes. They might have believed the nice things you said about me if you didn't keep reminding them what good friends we are. There was a time, quite a long time ago, when I thought that it was possible to maintain the rule of law almost indefinitely in the absence of democracy. That was a comfortable illusion, but an illusion nevertheless, and I have abandoned it. As a grandfather, hi Zane, hi Jack, hi Oliver, hi Asher, hi Luke. These are my grandchildren. And as a grandfather, I think of things in terms of the way young people think about them. And I think that if you manage to convince young people that you can have the rule of law in the absence of democracy, then having regard to what they feel about democracy, they will think less and less about the rule of law, and eventually they'll think practically nothing of it at all. In 2010, I was called upon to attend a judicial conference in London, which was about democracy and the rule of law. And for the first time, I felt it necessary to ask myself the question whether in the absence of full democracy, it was possible to have the rule of law. And I gave a qualified answer, yes. I qualified it by these conditions. One, that you had to have a justiciable constitution in the hands of of an independent judiciary. Secondly, I said, you had to have a proper separation of powers. Thirdly, it was necessary to have human rights protected in conformity with international norms. Fourthly, it was necessary that you never permit whatever you manage to achieve in the maintenance of the rule of law, even in advance of the full evolution of democracy, to be used as an excuse to delay democratic development. Martin Lee told me that he thought my answer was wrong, but he thought I was right to give that answer. Politician. Because he thought it would be too negative to say that you can't. Now, that was some time ago, 2010. 5 years have passed since then. And it's not only the passage of 5 years, but these two facts. At that time, although there was huge debate, controversy, and party political controversy as to how democracy ought to develop, the pace at which it ought to develop, I think everybody was agreed that the process was going forward. And it's only a question of how it was going forward. But at the moment, although everybody wants to blame everybody else as to why that is so, I think we all pretty much agree that the process is at present stalled. And of course, the 5 years is quite a long time. It is a long time in the context of a mere 50 years subject to a possible extension, a mere 50 years for the separate system. So I think that there may come a time, before too long, when we have to say that what we have is not the rule of law, but an approximation of the rule of law. If you flat out insisted that you had the rule of law, even in the absence of developed democracy, I think a lot of people who regard democracy as important, both as a principle and as a means of bringing change highly relevant to their lives, including the cost of putting a roof over your head, if you insisted that you can have the rule of law in the absence of democracy, some people might, unfortunately, believe you. But then they won't think very much of the rule of law, will they? They will think it's some lawyer's mantra, but not really important to people's lives. So I think that we might have to say that this is now only an approximation. It is not the only time in history where an honest assessment of the situation would have drawn the answer. This is an approximation of the rule of law, not the rule of law. I think in Britain, before women had the vote, whatever anybody might have said about the rule of law, on the way that we understand the rule of law now, it's nonsense to disenfranchise women or leave them unenfranchised and say, you have the rule of law, you don't. But if we only have an approximation of the rule of law, what should we do about it? Well, the first thing is to address the very reason why we have no more
than an approximation, which is the democratic deficit. Now, the Constitution points in the right direction. It declares the ultimate aim to be universal suffrage, both in relation to the election of all the members of the Legislative Council, it says all the members, because everybody knows that some are returned by universal suffrage, some are not. Functional constituencies, Margaret, and you represent the only decent one. Now, that's what it says in relation to the Legislative Council, all the members. And in relation to the Chief Executive, it also declares universal suffrage as to be as the ultimate aim on the nomination of a broadly placed nominating committee. I said on television, so I can't get away from it, that whether you like it or not, that provision is there. But what does it mean? And I said, well, whatever it means, it must mean that the nomination committee, both in the way it's constituted and the way it operates, should be the servant and not the opponent of the ultimate aim. Have an ultimate aim, and you have a mechanism, then you have the mechanism designed to serve the ultimate aim and not to divert one away from the ultimate aim. So one can argue that. But that must ultimately, I think, be so. The other thing to do, of course, is to make the approximation as close as possible to the reality. Now, if the reason why it's only an approximation is the democratic deficit, and you're already working with that democratic deficit, then the only thing now is to see how you can deal with the approximation to bring it closer and closer to the reality. There may be a number of ways. I think, to my mind, the most obvious way is to make rapid advance in the enforcement of socio-economic rights. Now, I say that for this reason, that in seeking their socio-economic rights, people in evolved democracies tend to look to the electoral process. That is not to say that they never resort to constitutional adjudication. They do. But essentially, if you have a working democracy, then you look to the electoral process for socio-economic rights after all. This involves the allocation of funds, which is essentially the responsibility of the political branches of government rather than the judicial branch of government. That is not to say that the judiciary, here and elsewhere, do not have a role in dealing with socioeconomic rights. I mean, certainly the Federal Supreme Court of Switzerland openly recognized the limited capacity of a court acting through the judicial process to deal with the allocation of public money, but said that if people are being denied their basic constitutional rights, the court is obliged to intervene. And one has seen the enforcement of socioeconomic rights sometimes through the civil and political rights. That happened in famously in the Supreme Court of India, the Olga Tellis case, when the right to a livelihood was in a non-justiciable part of the Constitution. But the Supreme Court of India said, well, the right of livelihood is related to the right to life, and the right to life is one of the justiciable rights. And they enforced it to the extent that they felt able to through the right to life. The Supreme Court of Pakistan did much the same thing when people were complaining about bonded labor and things of this sort. You might say that, well, it's a socioeconomic field, but it's not uncommon to enforce a socioeconomic right, and there's a redundant relation to a right to health, which is usually found in the socioeconomic elements of the Constitution. In terms of the covenant, the right to health is dealt with in the ICSCR rather than ICPR, but the Supreme Court of Pakistan said, well, look, if they are complaining about electrical emissions, which is a danger to health, surely the right to life includes the right to a clean environment, and they enforced it. So there's much that one can do, but I think ultimately it is necessary to pay attention to the identical treatment in Article 39 of the Basic Law accorded to both of the covenants, the civil and political covenant and the socioeconomic covenant, say so. The difference, of course, is that the Hong Kong Bill of Rights is the embodiment of the application to Hong Kong of the ICCPR, and there's no such equivalent for the ICSCR. But nevertheless, it's there. And you know, Tom Bingham, who knows these things better than him, said that part of the rule of law is a state honoring its international obligations. And the ICSCR is a treaty to which Britain extended to Hong Kong, and which the People's Republic of China continues to treat as extended to Hong Kong. So if you don't enforce those rights properly, one can raise a serious question about the impact on the rule of law directly. Now, people will press for democracy in some ways which may involve a breach of the letter of the law. This is civil disobedience. I mean, when Gandhi made salt, he had every intention of breaching the letter of the law, but he was trying to, he was involved in a struggle of national liberation. In Hong Kong, the question is whether we have any such situation. People will do what they think it's right to do. But I think we should remember that the Constitution is on our side. And one should try to look for lawful means of pursuing these constitutional rights. In saying this, I am wholly aware that there are situations in which the courts are placed in the very uncomfortable position of being an impediment to progress. It did happen during the suffragette movement. Perhaps the judges in compliance with their judicial oath could not do otherwise. They could have resigned, I suppose. But if you stay in office, you do sometimes have to do things which really put you against progressives. I have spent my life in a courtroom, which is the most important part of the court. Well, I suppose at any given time where the most worthy person happens to be sitting or standing. Might be the witness box. I've certainly been in courtroom when I thought by far the most worthy person in court wasn't the witness box. A young boy who had the courage to give evidence against a number of tried members. In fact, they intimidated all the witnesses. He was so small and so young, they forgot to intimidate him. But he gave evidence against them. Sometimes the most honorable person in the court is sitting at the back. Maybe a mother who's there supporting her children in their hour of need. It might be an advocate. Sounds strange, but sometimes you have advocates of the quality of Johannes or Margaret, and anything's possible. Sometimes the most honorable person in the court might occupy the dock. Mandela was there. Gandhi was there. And Robert Emmet was there. And the greatest things they always said was during the allocutus, when they were asked whether they had anything to say before sentence was passed upon them. Mandela's, if need be. Gandhi's invitation to the court to pass the most severe sentence on him, because he did intend to oppose the regime to the full extent within his capacity. And most memorably, Robert Emmet, the Irish patriot. Let me rest in peace and obscurity. My memory in oblivion and my tombstone uninscribed, till other times and other men can do justice to my character. When my country takes its place among the nations of the world, then, and not until then, let my epitaph be written. These things that you can quote from the dock measure up to anything that's ever been delivered from the bench. And although I risk my credibility by even raising the possibility, sometimes the most honorable position in the court is even the bench. It is possible. So we live in very difficult times, and I think that the direction in which the law is moving is the right one. The movement may be almost imperceptible sometimes. But the law can't be that bad. Or we wouldn't have so many young people, so many worthy young people, still prepared to pursue a career in the law. I have always recognized, ever since my retirement, that I am now yesterday's man. And it is not for me to open broad vistas of tomorrow, but in the day after tomorrow, which is the day of those who are students now, I have complete faith. I believe that Hong Kong will thrive. How? I'm not sure. But we have overcome all sorts of difficulties in the past, and the way that we did it was probably not predictable when we were facing the struggle, but we managed to do it. I have never attempted to hide from young people the size of the problem. Why should I lie to you? But I am not sugarcoating the pill when I say that I believe that you will overcome it. And I thank you. I thank you for what you will do, because you will do it in your time when my grandchildren are still growing up. And on their behalf, I thank you very much. And now I've said it.
Thank you, Kemi, particularly when you end on such an optimistic note, and which I recall just a few weeks ago at the opening of the law school to the new students, I told the new students also something similar, in that if history is of any guidance, then the fate of Hong Kong after 2047 will have to be decided at least 15 to 20 years ahead. So which means it has to be sealed by 2030, and we are now 2015, and it's not that far away, and the burden of driving what happened after 2047 will fall on the burden of the law students today. By then, they will be the central pillar of our society, and they will be the one bearing the torch to see the way through, and what happened in the next 10 to 15 years will be extremely crucial to determine what will happen after 2047. Kemi has touched on a wide range of issues, from rule of law, democracy, socio-economic rights, civil disobedience, and so on. I'm sure that would whet your appetite to raise a whole range of questions. And one thing he mentioned about his speech in London, which he subsequently published, and which he believed that rule of law could thrive even without democracy under certain conditions. Indeed, I quote him in an article just 2 months ago, and when I had lunch with him a month ago, showing him my article, he told me, I've changed my mind now. but I'd like to pick up your theme that that's good, right, John? And when you talk about democracy deficit, and one way to do it is the rapid advances in socio-economic rights. I have 2 points there. One is, for those who advocate democracy, one of the strongest opposition they face is precisely democracy will lead to the demand for more socio-economic rights, and it will lead to a welfare state. So would that be a counter thesis to what people are advocating of democracy, and then fall exactly into those who oppose democracy? And a related, a second point is, you also mentioned that the court could be enlightening, and indeed we see some very enlightened judgments on our court, and very controversial as well, especially when we come to socio-economic rights. Now, how far you think the court is right, or is right for the court to lead the change And indeed, in the last 10, 20 years, we have seen when, because of democracy deficit, the debate in legislature leads to nowhere. The government is not responding to public demands. So people turn to court, and now the court becomes the main engine for social change, rightly or wrongly, and some people believe that's right. So do you see that that should, or that whether that should be the role of the court? But if not, could the court get away from it when people are expecting that? And more social changes, they are hoping that the court will take the lead now.
Now, before I answer you, Yasmin, if you've got to go, you can go now. I'm just on to my daughter. Don't worry, nobody's going to think you're walking on your dad. Well, you know, Johannes, I mean, no court can cook up a socioeconomic right. It will be provided in a constitutional text. And the only way that you can discourage the court from enforcing it is by saying it doesn't mean what it says, frankly. And I think a lot of times that's exactly what people intend. They pass these things into it. I'm not exactly sure what a welfare state is. What is the opposite of it? I don't think that ultimately people are interested in walking along the wall in order to find the point of least resistance and then pursuing self-interest along those lines of least resistance. The truth of the matter is that people, the vast majority of people, are hugely disadvantaged. And if the way to eliminate this injustice is create a welfare state, and let's create it. I mean, I might be a traitor to my class. I have not the slightest doubt that greater democracy in Hong Kong wouldn't be to my economic interests. I have been riding this gravy train very comfortably for a very long time and could go on riding it forever, actually. But, you know, is this the sort of world that you want? And what I mean, you know, I see Margaret's lips are really curling, that I'm incapable of saying anything for more than 5 minutes without referring to my grandchildren. I mean, what sort of world do I want them to grow up in? They'll be all right. So do I want them to be troubled in their conscience that they're all right but so many other people aren't? I don't think they'd be very happy that way. Or do I want them to develop such a thick skin of selfishness that they are not troubled? I just don't see it myself. And there is, in fact, a very great limit on what the courts can do by way of socioeconomic rights. It usually helps the most disadvantaged. Most people are concerned, they will look to the political process. And if you look at the most successful countries nowadays, they are democracies. People do quite well, nobody's starving, but there are some people fabulously rich. Nothing wrong with that, somebody has to be. So yes, if you have a developed, and Hong Kong is ideally placed, actually, to go forward on a democratic basis. So if you ask about the enforcement of socioeconomic rights, it has to be there. The courts can't dream it up. And if we could do less because somebody else is doing more, we'd be more than happy.
Talking about traitor of my class, I remember there was a story that the Soviet leader, Khrushchev, once met the Chinese Premier Zhou Enlai at a UN meeting. So they shook hands with one another, and then Khrushchev looked down upon Zhou Enlai and said that, you know, Mr. Chow, we are both communists, but we are different. You come from a bourgeoisie family, and I come from a peasant family. And Joe replied, that's absolutely right, but we have one thing in common. We both betray our class. So let's listen to what a young man said. Tony, what do you think?
Thank you, Professor Shen. I have a question in mind. Now, Hong Kong is at its crossroads. As we all know, we are going to, we are in the midway of the 50 years pledge. For our generation, how can we prepare and what should we do in order to ensure that there will be no enormous or drastic changes in our lifestyle and legal system? Without the legal system we are having now, then democracy and other stuff will just be impossible for us to discuss.
Johannes is thinking of an answer. Now, I don't know what answer you might think of. My own is this, that if we're talking about the law, and we are talking about looking at it from the point of view of a lawyer, then the first thing that the lawyer must do, and this is every lawyer, I mean, whether he's an in-house lawyer, a lawyer in private practice, a lawyer in the academy, a lawyer on the bench, whenever you're serving any number of causes, the first thing you've got to do is you've got to be efficient in your job. Now, when the law societies say something through the president, that's very often listened to with considerable respect. In fact, people would be surprised how few solicitors there are. The chairman of the bar is listened to with respect. People would be even more surprised how few barristers there are. But by and large, I think people think that lawyers are doing their own jobs. And we must look to our own efficiency. I mean, it's disgraceful if we allow delays, we tolerate a system where people are unrepresented, all of these things. So we've got to do our own job properly. Now, that's the first thing. Because the law only plays a very small part in this. I'm not saying that this is because our role is unimportant. It's simply because there are so many different people playing their role. And we have to do our jobs. And so that's what principally you have to do if you become a lawyer, if you want to be a good lawyer. So if people want to sell their house, you don't make a mess of the transactions, the biggest contract they'll ever enter into, in all probability. If people have a claim, you've got to see that the claim is brought to court quickly. And if people are in need of criminal defense, they should have it. The lawyers should not be wasting time endlessly. I mean, quite honestly, one of the greatest deprivations of liberty is long-windedness in court. I mean, if you spend a lot of time wasting the court's time in criminal cases, there's no skin off the judge's nose if he's not trying this case, if he's trying another one. But there's somebody waiting in the queue for his case to come on, and this person might well be among one who will be acquitted, even rightly acquitted. And if some long-winded in court puts his case back by 2 weeks, then he's been jailed for 2 weeks by a long-winded person. So we must do our jobs efficiently. That's something which we have to do. You have a wider social conscience, but you do your job properly, and that's the main thing that one would say to a lawyer. There's all the other things I could say to young people. And at my age, they won't laugh too loud. They'd just be quite tolerant. But I'm not here to lecture people on all their behaviours. But if I'm talking about lawyers, what I'm saying is be good at your job. In fact, the highest duty is to be efficient.
The only two things I would add, one is to read more. A little knowledge is always dangerous. And we have seen increasingly is sometimes people just cling on one or two simple and highly simplified concepts and as if they know the things. And so at this time and age, I think read more is even more important to equip yourself. The other thing, apart from being a competent and efficient lawyer, is the commitment. The commitment not only to your job, but the commitment to the system. And one thing I feel, which is common among all great lawyers, is they believe in the system. The system is not perfect. At times it works in justice, but by and large it works. And we have to believe in the system and in the values of the system, what's underlying, and this is really taken from Camus in one of his talks before, is law without values is nothing but naked powers. So with this, we might open to the floor. If you have any questions, feel free, raise your hands, identify yourself, and you either will make a point or raise questions with Camus.
Now, it's been said that the law of the nation sits uncomfortably somewhere between its morality and its economics. And there's not the slightest doubt that the modern trend is to provide for socioeconomic rights. There's an international covenant there. But in most places, they would think that you can pursue these economic rights or economic aspirations through the ballot box. And that is legitimate, because you're talking about the distribution of public funds. When I have never, however much I thought that the judiciary was understaffed, ever suggested we ought to have another court or something of that sort. It's not my business, but I would never say that, because people would say, well, what do you want? Less nurses in hospitals, less schools. So these are great difficulties. And the court is dealing with those socioeconomic rights, which usually are at a bare minimum, quite honestly. The rule of law undoubtedly involves democracy, because the modern conception of the rule of law is that it involves human rights and the right to choose how you are governed is a human right. It was said that the average Stone Age individual had more personal autonomy than the average citizen who developed democracy. That is true. We give up some of our personal autonomy to live in organized society. And in organized society, we give up some of our freedom to those who are entitled to rule us. So it seems very strange if people don't choose those who rule them. And in any event, even if I was totally wrong in all of this, people now want it. And there will be turmoil if they don't have it. So we do have to develop this element of rule of law. And when talking about it, I diminish my own role as a judge, because I'm really saying, well, you know, these responsibilities lie elsewhere. All we say is that if it's not done elsewhere and the responsibility falls on us, then we will accept the added responsibility. We don't want it. And there it is. But there is really no choice now, and you know, it's an idea that as time has come. I think there's an Ecuadorian proverb that he who stands in the way of an idea whose time has come has his hand on the sun.
Thank you.
Yes.
Gentlemen, next one. Elgin, law graduate, STEM, and wrote on behalf of the woman, not female. Just a very quick question on two parts. One, we recently had a very epidemic yet political debate about whether we have a separation of power in Hong Kong and how the Chinese were trying to accuse Hong Kong of having not enough decolonization. Why does this Chinese factor constantly come up? Was it because that you see the untrust into the judiciary branch? Second, you have referred to the constitution in relation to the protest, and you said the constitution has been on the young people's side. But this is exactly how they felt the opposite, because they felt they couldn't do much to change, and yet the power was never given up by whoever in power. If we look into the case of Gandhi and Mandela, it was actually the administration which steps down and make a fundamental change, and you can actually see signs of the and to be more exact, how the government should actually respond to these demands.
For the benefit of students on the seventh floor, because they might not be able to hear exactly the question, so I just paraphrase the question, two questions. One is the recent controversy surrounding separation of powers and decolonization. Does it reflect a lack of trust on the judiciary? And the second question is when we say the constitution is on the young people, many young people feel the other way.
Now, in relation to the separation of powers, the idea behind it is that if you have power collected in a single person or single body of persons, that will ultimately lead to an abuse of power and despotism. The extent to which the separation of powers exists in Hong Kong depends on examination of our actual arrangements. There is provision for the three branches of government, the two political branches consisting of the executive and legislature and the judicial branch. Now, the functions of each is provided for by the Constitution. And you don't superimpose upon the Constitution some idea of the separation of powers to make the structural arrangements of the Constitution different from what they are. The structural arrangements are there. I think that they do reveal a separation of powers. Now, I myself have seen it this way. As far as judicial independence of Hong Kong is concerned, I believe that we have it subject to one thing, which is the power of the Standing Committee to interpret and reinterpret the basic law. But this is a feature of the one country, two systems principle, and have a regard to the extent to which the standing committee has delegated the interpretive power to the Hong Kong courts. If the system is operated appropriately, I think you have an acceptable situation. As far as the legislature is concerned, if anything, there is a greater separation in Hong Kong between the executive and legislature than in Westminster, where the executive is formed from the legislature by the party that can command a majority in the legislature, whereas here it's separate. So it seems to me there's a greater separation of powers in that regard. And if anything, people are saying, well, if you allow elections for the chief executive, which reflects universal suffrage, you may have a much closer relationship between the executive and the legislature. That wouldn't be a bad thing. So it does seem to me that there really is very little room for abstract debate. The provisions are there. And the only complaint, seriously, about the political branches of government is the way they're formed. I know that the expression has been used that the chief executive is in some transcendent position. But it doesn't really matter. It's a word, and quite honestly, I mean, in many ways it helps the democratic movement, there might be some members of it here, because it was simply emphasized to people, if it's an accurate description of position, how important it is that the chief executive be selected by universal suffrage. But ultimately it comes to function. Now look, the Court of Final Appeal is the apex court in Hong Kong. But supposing the whole of the Court of Final Appeal, every single member of it, permanent and non-permanent, decided to go down and visit the magistrate's court. And we all sat at the back, and there was an argument about whether the lights were red or the lights were green at the time of the accident. And we've sat there the whole time, and every single one of us thinks that the witnesses who said that the lights were red were telling the truth. And it was absolute nonsense that these people were saying when they said the lights were the other color. Well, there's nothing. We can't go and tell the magistrate, by the way, you go and find that the lights were red, because we all think that. So what? So, I mean, if you ask whether the Court of Final Appeal is superior to the magistrate's court in the judicial hierarchy, then of course it is, but we couldn't go and tell him to find that the lights were this color or that color. So ultimately, whether you want to use one expression or not, there's no need to get into a quarrel about it, I think it'll still function appropriately. I know people will worry, you know, what does this mean, and you know, does this mean to say that there may be reinterpretations, and if anybody complains about it, they say, well, look, the chief executive saw this reinterpretation, and you know, that's nothing wrong with that. But people will worry about it. But ultimately, the judges will do their jobs properly. I mean, I hope people believe me. I say this, and people might say, well, they're all your friends. We don't believe you. We don't even believe, we think you're wrong in thinking the judge would behave properly. We don't think that even you would behave properly. Well, I can't stop them from thinking that. But I have faith in my colleagues, and I think that they will do their jobs appropriately, that for the judiciary.
I could never understand this transcendence thing. And I think in the last 12 years, I was the dean of the faculty, and as the dean, I was the head of the Faculty of Law. At the same time, I was appointed by the president as the appointed dean and belonging to part of the senior management of the university. The fact that I'm appointed by the president didn't make me transcendent above my faculty. Just like the fact that the CE is appointed by the central government, how could that lead to a conclusion that he is transcend about the free branch? If only thing is simply my own experiences, as a result, I'm torn between two loyalties from time to time and make life as a dean terrible and horrible. So I don't understand the logic, but then a lot of this debate is to some extent misguided, because we are all using the same phrase, separation of powers, to mean something very differently. And on the one hand, we see concentration of power is always a dangerous thing, and one can attribute the prevalence of corruption in China to a large extent is because powers are unchecked, and powers are unchecked at every level and resulting in corruption at every level then. On the other hand, is once you believe that there is checks and balance, it doesn't matter whether you call it separation of power, there could be more than one version of separation of power. And separation of powers could sometimes be used in a way which probably those who criticize it have not contemplated. For example, in our court, the court has used separation of power as a reason not to interfere into the management internal operation of the legislature, so all things about filibustering and so on, and whether the chairman or president of legislature can stop the debate, the court basically go back to legislature. We have to respect the legislature as an institution. It is not for the court to tell them how to run their own business. That is not the sort of things that those who criticize separation of powers have in mind. It could work the other way around as well.
Yes, Margaret.
Yes. Disrespectful comment. We are obsessed with now the separation of powers recently, and the three branches, and I'm looking at the three mascots there, you know, Croppy and Foxy and Stinky. Now, is there any symbolism in that? I wish that Croppy is much larger than the others. In words, the law is a crocodile, so Croppy is the law, and I don't want to comment on who the other two are. it is rather daunting to me that Croppy is so much larger. And I mean, if you look at it, it is only the head, and already the head is larger than the two of them put together. You know, so now, the less maybe the even more disrespectful question is this. I have felt increasingly that in Hong Kong, people who fight for democracy and human rights and a fairer society increasingly concentrate on the judiciary. Now, is that healthy? Are we putting too much on the judiciary? Here, Johannes was saying that actually when you talk about the separation of powers, what you're looking for is check and balance. Here is a fundamental difference between the culture here and the culture which is in the mainland in Beijing. And that is, their culture believes that in order for the government to be efficient, is of paramount importance for the government to, or the party, to be efficient, to be powerful, so that there is no opposition and they can do everything in the best interest of the country. So they think that stability is concentration of power and the absence of opposition. But here in this little island, we believe that the only real stability comes from check and balance between the powers. Now my question is, increasingly we find Hong Kong people putting their trust, their faith, their hope, their final defense on an independent judiciary. So nowhere else in the world do you see common people talk about judicial review all the time. If they have a problem, they say we'll go to judicial review.
Do you think that that is a sign that the weakness in the, or the lack of trust by the people in the two other branches of the government is putting too much on the judiciary? And is the judiciary able to carry so much? You seem not to think that, that there's too much on the judiciary because you are saying let's do a little bit more, even social economic rights, you know. So where do you think we are going there? Are we placing too much hope on the judiciary beyond what the judiciary can reasonably bear?
Tony, you want to summarize that question? That's unfair. But basically, is it a misplaced trust and unreal expectation on the judiciary that at the end of the day, by putting too much emphasis and too much hope on the independence of the judiciary, we actually harm that principle?
Sorry.
Johannes, we're talking about checks or corruption. I mean, either it's got to be check or it's got to be cash. But look, Margaret, you're just angry because you think it's appropriate to make a stink, and I've made the I made the skunk rather small. But you know, this is not my fault. This is the way nature made them. That's their size. But now look, of course it's unhealthy that so much reliance has to be placed on judiciary. Highly unhealthy, but supposing people are putting faith in judiciary when there are other avenues that they can pursue, then of course one must channel them to those other avenues. But if those other avenues are closed, then it'd be even more unhealthy if the judiciary said, well, sorry, that is the appropriate avenue. The fact that it's closed to you means there's no avenue. But that can't be done. And I have always said, and much of this evening's talk is directed towards that really there's need for democratic development. Otherwise, I could just talk about judiciary endlessly, about the rule of law, and trot out all these wonderful things. But I'm just recognizing what is taken for granted in other parts of the world. The all of the rights, however basic, are illusory if the right to vote is undermined. Now, where was that said? That was said in the most powerful court in the world today, the United States Supreme Court. So that is a fact. Judiciary has a role. It shouldn't be asked to carry a greater burden than is appropriate. But if people come to the court because they have no other avenue, then the court has to see what it can do. Now, as far as the system in the mainland being different, and you have summarized it, I'm in no position to judge the accuracy otherwise of the summary, because I'm not a politician. But it's not necessary to see whether I wholly understand the mainland system or not, because we're operating on one country, two systems. And what might be totally appropriate in one part of the country, or every other part of the country, apart from Hong Kong, is seen by the mainland authorities as not appropriate in Hong Kong, hence the one country, two systems principle. So in insisting on our way of doing things, we are not challenging the mainland authorities. We are just doing precisely what they have chosen to do, live out a separate system. So there is the possibility of lowering the temperature and taking it forward. And perhaps we can do it. Maybe everybody does have to take a deep breath and think about it. But there it is. It's not an easy situation. I agree with you that there's an unhealthy development, but perhaps a necessary one.
Question and a comment, and the comment is that I'm very glad that you have such faith in our generation of law students in upholding the rule of law in Hong Kong, but I feel that the faith is rather misplaced, because as a lawyer to be a law student, I feel that so much that concerns the rule of law happens outside the courtroom. For example, we know that certain land laws and environmental regulations are just not enforced in new territories because government wouldn't do it. For fear of trouble. And we also know that, for example, the policemen which beat up the protester in Occupy Central, during Occupy Central protests, the names still haven't been revealed. These things happen outside of the courtroom, and it's not up to lawyers to determine what the government does or does not do. And so I feel that much more has to happen outside of the courtroom and outside of the law school for Hong Kong to fully develop into a territory embodying the rule of law. And the question is, Hong Kong courts have made a few rulings on the constitutionality of certain laws. For example, the Billy Loan ruling on the age of consent for homosexuals, and the ruling regarding transgender marriage in W case. And the Legislative Council has taken a lot of time to render them into law. In the Billy Loan case, it's been 10 years. Before it was rendered into law, and in the W case, the government's proposal was shot down. So do you think that's an unhealthy development, that the legislative seems to be rather reluctant to give effect to the court's rulings?
Well, you've just, by what you've said, increased my confidence in your generation. Because you have recognize that there's a lot that goes on outside the courtroom. Most of the world goes on outside the courtroom. And perhaps I've spoken less about the law and more about society generally than you would expect from a judge. Precisely because so much goes on outside. Now, one of the reasons why I have a lot of faith in your generation is that you have grown up seeing these problems. Now, the sort of lawyer I was, I was dealing purely with lawyers' law. There was no such thing as constitutional adjudication in any realistic sense. All the public law cases I did were regulatory matters. Most of the cases I did were commercial cases. And, you know, I had a great time and made quite a lot of money. You know, when the clients are both old and ugly enough to look after themselves and pay your fees, it was a very carefree time. And if even somebody growing up in my situation can ultimately be made to see a bit of the light, then you people who have been seeing it right from the start will have capacities beyond what I can see and can only guess at, and beyond what you can see at the moment. But you will rise to it. And you're not the only young people. There are other people, in other fields of life. I've often said that if you are interested, say, in human rights, it doesn't mean to say that you have to be a lawyer, or if you have be a lawyer, it doesn't mean to say you have to argue human rights cases in the courts. If you became the senior partner of a leading firm of solicitors, but in your heart you had the right ideas, you'll be vastly influential. In-house lawyers can convince their clients of these things much better than somebody who's well known to be a sort of rather slightly radical lawyer. Now, why do you think that I have enlisted the help of Crocky and Stinky and Owly and Fox and all these people? Because people might accept it from them even though they may accept it from me. John Mortimer said that he used Rumpel as the sort of person that the great British public would probably take it from. If a lefty lawyer like John Mortimer, a bit artistic, spoke about presumption of innocence, people would be very suspicious of it. But a man like Rumpel, who likes his glass of red wine, and he likes his steak kidney put, then people will see it as a value. So you are dealing with the whole of society. And as a lawyer, the image that you would present as a convincing one is not, you know, just the black letter type of lawyer, which nobody likes, or somebody who is sort of radical in every matter which scares other people. But if you develop yourself to be a highly efficient lawyer, but with your heart in the right place, then you will feel, you will see that you'll meet all sorts of people in different walks of life, and the law will play its part. But much of it does take place outside. But as far as the transgender marriage is concerned, we gave it a suspension so that it can be dealt with in a more orderly way. But if they don't deal with it, it will happen. So there it is.
I'd think it's absolutely right that a lot of things happen outside court, and court is just one part of society. But all the more, it means that there are a lot more we can do as a lawyer outside the court. And yes, there are people who are beaten up, there are a lot of people who need legal assistance, and they are not rich, and they are beyond the reach of legal aid. There are a lot more that lawyers can do without going into court. And on the wider scale, of course, with your analytical skills, with your advocacy training, lawyers could be great advocates for social changes, advocates to speak out on injustice, on unfairness. And the reason I started 5 years ago, I decided to start a legal clinic here, offering pro bono services. And one of the main vision to do it is the kind of pro bono culture that we as a lawyer, as future lawyer, law students, we can give back to society. That kind of pro bono culture has to start when you are young, and then it may well be 10 years down the road when you are the partner of a law firm, you are in a position to offer pro bono service, which unfortunately in Hong Kong is still not as common as it should be. And a lot of large firms, they do not offer pro bono service at all, which I think is a sad thing, which is something which we should advocate for change. And our legal clinic has established for 5 years. We have taken up over 600 cases now, and providing a lot of services. A lot of them may not be inside court, but outside, advisors, assistants, help them to get legal aid. And it is a very gratifying experience, apart from the learning experience. And it is this kind of values that we know, although in a small way, and we don't expect anyone or all of our graduates will become Gandhi or Nelson Mandela. But by doing your job properly, that in a way is the best way to contribute to the rule of law in whatever position. As Kemi said, sometimes stingy may be the better way to express the view. And we have some very good lawyers working in finance and securities. When they talk to their counterpart how a regulatory system works, and the whole regulatory system is about rule of law, about transparency, about fairness. Is there a lady over there? Yes.
My name's Ryan, I'm a law student.
Right.
And firstly, I have to agree with your point about a lawyer not, that they can do things that are outside the court, because I personally know the legal was involved in the Asian concept case, and he has done so many things that are out of the court, like he goes to a lot of
student covers two parts in his question about the obstacles of Hong Kong democracy, as well as his inherent distrust or mistrust on Chinese culture in promoting democracy.
Well, now, most societies had some sort of leader who governed by some sort of consensus, sprung of all sorts of different notions. Very often it was the leader's ability to protect them against marauders and people of the sort. I mean, I think the Vikings, for example, did a lot for the feudal system. It was actually a feudal lord who was capable of protecting them, putting up some form of protection. And if you have a concept of an emperor who alone could pray for a good harvest and so on and so forth, well, there's no need for a great argument of democracy, because most people, if they were asked to elect, would elect the person whom they believe could pray for a good harvest. But when people abandon these ideas of kingship, then they have to find some other way of doing it. You could either say, well, every man will maintain his own, and every woman will maintain her own complete autonomy, but that wouldn't be organized society. You could say that we'll put everything to a referendum. And in a village, you could have something pretty close to that. Most people get on with their own lives, and then if there's a big discussion, everybody can get around and sit around and discuss it. But in a slightly more sophisticated society, you have to have representative democracy. You've got to elect a person. So ultimately, democracy comes up because you say, well, all right, somebody's got to run it. But who's going to run it? And the majority of people will say, well, somebody we choose. Well, that's all, unless you flip a coin. So once you have a situation where there is not a obvious leader, in a family group you might say, well, I mean, the obvious leaders are the children, because the parents will do everything that they can for the children. The children are the leaders of the family, but the parents are the trustees to look after them. But in a larger society, so I think that no traditional mistrust of democracy would actually impede the development of democracy in Chinese society. After all, the emperor's gone. And most people would say, yes, you could have a good leader by descent. I mean, it's quite possible. You could have an absolute idiot win an election, or a wonderful king, a philosopher king. But I think ultimately it just gets down to say, well, how else are we going to do it? And sometimes this mistrust of democracy is just used when it looks as if society is fairly stable and some people are agitating for change. And then they just say, what's all this about, and is democracy an all-healing panacea? Well, of course it's not. I mean, if you have a toothache, democracy is not going to take care of it. And in all these evolved societies, they have the courts, they have all sorts of other systems. But if you were to take away democracy, people would notice that. So I don't think there is really any part of Chinese thinking that is anti-democratic. I mean, Chinese people, for many centuries, have been highly sophisticated and developed, and really world leaders. And at a time when kingship was the norm, that was so. But in today's, I think people think along those lines. There are many different ways of selecting your leaders, of course, and not any single one. But the ultimate concept is that I'm going to give up my autonomy, my individual autonomy, to a representative. I want to have a say in choosing the representative, and that's all that one has to get across. Now, there are other parts of your question, but I have answered one part of it. Perhaps Johannes would like to deal with the rest.
In 1776, three gentlemen decide to publish a series of articles in New York Times expressing their views about what the Constitution should be, led by Alexander Hamilton. And these series of newspaper articles were collected together to become a book known as the Federalist Paper. And this Federalist Paper is one of the most influential books ever written on constitutionalism. The one thing to learn is probably our UGC people should revise what is important about referees article. None of these have referees. But in some of the writings by Alexander Hamilton about the constitutional makeup of US, why the election of the president is not based by popular democracy, but by the state electors. The electors are the state, and the number of votes depends on the size of the population. And I think it might be paper number 83, that is that the precise reason why we designed this system is we cannot trust the people to select the presidents. Now, of course, today, US is regarded exemplary of this democracy. But then when we go back to the founding father, this kind of skepticism in US exists at the very day when they designed the system. So in that sense, if the story can give us some optimism, is the current obstacles to democracy, it is no different to what we have seen in other countries. They have gone through it. Probably we have to go through that stage. And you just keep educating people, keep arguing, keep debating on this matter. The other point is open mind. I think China is a terribly complex body with conflicting views there. It is dangerous to regard China as only one view, and that view is always anti-democratic. There are very liberal-minded people. I know many liberal scholars, colleagues in mainland China, who are more outspoken than we do. And so one thing I would encourage is to keep an open mind, to prepare to listen. One thing I'm quite worried in the last 12 months is we are less and less tolerant of different views. And that happens in both camps. As long as this is not a democratic view, I don't like it. As long as this is a democratic view, I don't like it. Depending on which camp you sit in. One of the legal training is that we always listen to the other side. There are always two sides of the arguments, otherwise case would not go to court. They were settled outside court already. So any case, if they manage to go to CAMI, to the Court of Final Appeal, that means there must be arguments on both sides. So try to keep an open mind. Don't shut out your mind simply because this is not something I want to hear, I'm willing to hear. And I think that applies to both sides. And with that open mind, probably I think we certainly need a lot more communications. We think we understand the Chinese system, and probably we don't. And they think they understand our system, or probably they don't either. And we may be using the same language, but talking something completely different. And underlying this, of course, there are 2,000 years of cultural heritage there, which sometimes is not easy to shed. My favorite example sometimes with the students is that the most famous judge we have in China in the last 2,000 years is and that's the single most important judge we have produced. But you have asked him who he is. He's the mayor of Haifeng, which is the chief executive. He directed Fu how to investigate the crime. He's the police chief. And then he decides how to present the cases, sometimes even to track the defendant. So he's the prosecutor, and then he's the judge. And in all the legendary stories, we've never heard that there's a right of appeal against this judgment. But then which leads me to think recently about these transcendent things. I think there's a lot of story about that, the transcendent things, the chief executive. And who is a good official in Chinese terms? A good official is someone who is virtuous, someone who loves the people, someone who behaves in a way that he looks like a parent. Fu Mou Gun. When we talk about Fu Mou Gun, they are the good officials because they know best as the parents. How do we call our civil servants? For a long tradition, we call them servant, public servant, civil servant, but that encapsulates a lot. Those who serve in public office, they are the servant. They are not transcending anyone. It is the other way around. They are right at the bottom to serve. Now, that, in a way, just in one sentence, you can see a very strong clash of values, which can goes back to 2,000 years of culture. So which means there are a lot more to do to better understand one another, to communicate with one another. Tony, are you reminding us of anything?
We'd like to welcome questions from the students, apart from like the legal law students. We'd like to have students from different backgrounds express your views. any students would like to? Yes, the lady at the back.
Sorry, I'm a law student.
Oh, yes.
You must give it back.
I'd like to ask about the judges' role in enforcing socioeconomic rights. Selection of judges are undemocratic. It's done by this judicial officer's recommendation commission. Basically, they are selected.
There's a member of it sitting here.
Judges are selected through this judicial officer's recommendation commission, if I'm not wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. So if there are three votes, like dissenting votes, then basically that recommendation will not be valid. And the Secretary for Justice is in this commission. So if he cast a dissenting vote on this recommendation of this judge, then do you think that the Secretary for Justice should be on this commission, the Judicial Office's Recommendation Commission, and what is your view on the undemocratic selection of judges in Hong Kong?
She's a law student, you can't trust her entirely. Well, you know, yeah, I mean, that's another reason why you need democracy, because the political branches of government are involved in the selection of judges and the funding of judiciary. Therefore, if you don't have democracy, legitimacy of the judiciary will come into question. Now, I used to serve on the Judicial Service Commission, and Eleanor, who's sitting there, was also a member of it at the time, and the chairman of the bar did say a number of things about whether the Attorney General ought to be on the commission. And you can argue the principle of it. All I can say is that in my time, I did not see either of the two attorney generals showing any signs of trying to manipulate the bench on anything other than merit. So that's in my time. I didn't see it. I mean, actually, I was told by an Australian Chief Justice, so it might even be accurate, that in Australia, the Attorney General virtually makes the appointments of the High Court of Australia. If he recommends somebody to the cabinet, the cabinet is very likely to appoint that person. But of course, the Attorney General himself is an elected person, as indeed the entire cabinet. So you can never have a completely satisfactory situation. I mean, Lionel Murphy was Attorney General, appointed himself to the High Court of Australia, and the then Chief Justice, Sir Garfield Barwick, was very unhappy, phoned up the Prime Minister and said, look, Gough, you appointed this chap, just think of how it will lower the intellectual capacity of the court. And the Prime Minister said, yes, but just think of how it will raise the intellectual capacity of the cabinet. So I don't care who they appoint, except that they appointed some of their own members, because they might be trying to shove them off onto you. So there it is. I mean, you know, it always is. I mean, in America, the president appoints the judges, and then the Senate has the power of confirmation, but they are all elected, and they have the democratic credentials to do it, you see. I mean, Albert Sanguinetti laughed after Bush and Gore. He said, oh, you know, the president picks the judges, and now the judges pick the president. But there it is. It's never going to be perfect. But I think that if the political branches of government are not democratically constituted, then there is a worry. But the Judicial Service Commission in my time, and they seem to be staffed by people of quality too now, have always looked to, as far as I can tell, professional abilities. That's all I can say. If I say more, you'll say, well, because you know them, they're friends, and then you trust them, why should we trust them? It is a bit difficult. I mean, one really wants to have institutional arrangements, but people who serve in the discussion can't help it. They don't say that there should be no democracy in Hong Kong. They give the best service they can in the system we have. Might as well say that I shouldn't have accepted judicial appointment because the people who appointed me were not democratically elected. I mean, I could have done that, I suppose, but you've got to get on with it, ultimately. But your point is legitimate and very much a part of everything we've been discussing this evening. Thank you. Glad I mentioned this.
Since the current Secretary for Justice is my former student, so I think I probably transcend that criticism. But having said that, personally, I would not object the presence of Secretary for Justice in the Judicial Service Commissions, apart from the personal integrity. Of course, he has the dual role. He's not only the government civil servants representing government, he's also the guardian of public interest. That is the constitutional role of the Secretary for Justice. And then after all, he represents half of the court users. All the prosecutions, they are users as well of the court. So it is not unfair that at least they should have a voice. After all, he's one out of nine. Whereas I have more reluctance or more reservations, and with due respect to Emma, is about the number of laymen on the Judicial Service Commissions. A judicial appointment can be vetoed if you have more than two dissenting votes. At the moment, we have three lay members, and in the past, yes, we have very respectable lay members, but I could never understand how lay members are appointed. The system itself is unclear. Who qualify as a layman? Occasionally, I was appointed to certain things which I don't regard myself as a layman as such, but nonetheless, I'm regarded as a layman. And I think if as a matter of system, if the judicial appointment could be vetoed by three persons, in theory, we could have an appointment veto by three persons who have the support of an entire legal profession, including the Secretary for Justice. Now, that seems to be something wrong there. If one reduced to two, at least if an appointment is to be vetoed, you have at least one member of the legal profession, no matter where it comes from, to support that. Although I understand probably in the actual working, you seldom have to go to vote like that. But that would be one thing. The other point I mentioned mentioned is that there's always a tension between independence and popular voting. For the legislator, the legitimacy of the legislator has to come from the people. They are authorized by the people to exercise the mandate. I don't think the same could apply to the judge, otherwise you compromise the independence. The legitimacy of the judiciary has to come from the process itself. It is an open process. It is an intellectual, rational process. Judge makes decision in open court only after hearing arguments. And then judge make their decisions by giving their reason, the detailed reasoning in their judgment, which is then open to scrutiny. I think that is the rational process itself which gives the legitimacy of the judiciary rather than in the voting system.
Gentleman at the back. I'm not really a lawyer. I've just started an LLM course, but I don't know much about law. At the beginning, you touched up on within the basic law, it's written in basic law that there's a nomination committee in order to nominate the candidates for the
chief executive. And some people are saying that, you know, they are fundamentally against that and want perhaps the basic law to be amended. Firstly, is it possible? Secondly, if it is possible, is it a dangerous path to go down? Because you can change something in your favor, but if it's changeable, then it, you know, something could be changed against you also.
Well, I mean, that is a view that I've always taken, that the basic law is very difficult to amend, and on the whole, the fact that it's very difficult to amend is a good thing rather than a bad one. The arguments about nomination have to do with what you can regard as a committee, basically. And I myself have said that the basic law makes that provision. But I did say that both in how you constitute the nominating committee and how the nominating committee, once constituted, carries out its functions, should all be geared to serving the aim of universal suffrage. Now, I think it has an element of comfort, not to put too fine a point on it, for the mainland, in case something goes very radically wrong. But I don't think that the people of Hong Kong would really elect somebody who, first of all, they thought would spend his whole time arguing with head office, which is not a very sensible way of proceeding, or who would do things which are contrary to the enlightened interests of Hong Kong. I mean, one of the ways of ending the debate about democracy and bringing the democracy movement to an absolute halt is by introducing democracy. That would stop to all of it. And then we'd be doing what I think a lot of people in 1997 thought we would be doing by now, which is refining the democracy. I mean, even in places which have evolved democracies, they constantly have debates about how you can make it more representative, more efficient, and so on. And then ultimately, for people to be getting on with their jobs once elected. So I think that it's unlikely that the basic law will be amended. I don't think it will be amended in this respect anyway. It does, within its terms, enable one to have, I think, meaningful democracy. I mean, it says universal suffrage. Why should we not believe it when it tells us that?
No law cannot be amended. same for constitution, so there will always be possibility to amend. Whether it's desirable to amend is quite another thing. And even if it's desirable amendment, particularly of a constitution, the highest law of the land, that should be the last resort when you have exhausted all other channel. And I think in our present cases, there are things which we could still do without amending the constitutions, which can still achieve what we want to achieve. And that is where the skill of a lawyer could come to. You have to go to the meticulous details. The other day, I had an interesting lunch with a leading professor from Peking Universities, and we had an interesting debate about this nomination committee. And he said, why do you think that it is not broadly representative? After all, they have 36 sectors representing all walks of life. And I said, of course, up to that point, I won't dispute with you. But then we go further down. Gender equality is something to be highly cherished. But pushing it to the point that Aberdeen Fishermen Association and Aberdeen Fisherwomen Association are separate voters, that's probably going a little bit beyond me. And when you have Sauki One Single Trawler Association, Sauki One Double Trawler Association, and Sauki One Triple Trawler Association, all sharing the same address now, there's something wrong there. And these are just local law. How to define who are the electors? You don't need to change the basic law, but if you want to do that, and it is not impossible to achieve insurance sector, why should we just give the underwriting companies to be the elector? There are a lot of brokers and all the major player in the insurance industry. They are qualified persons that you can define them by a clear definitions of professional qualifications, and you can identify the group of people, which you immediately enlarge the franchise at least 10 times more. So this would be, and I know the insurance sectors are moving along that line, they want to try to define the electors by reference to their professional qualifications. The same thing about IT and a whole lot of other sectors, there are things that one can do. It requires a little bit of thinking, a little bit more analysis, and a lot more persuasion, but I think that is where your legal training could come into play.
As we are drawing close to 8:30, we'd like to accommodate one more question, a final question from the student. Yes.
Hi, I'm a politics student, and what young people want is more than democracy. We want self-determination. So many of us think that it's impossible to get at our rights of self-determination under the basic law. So what do you think that to abolish the basic law? Because we are not involved in the drafting of the basic law, so what do you think about it? Thank you.
Now, I have taken an oath to uphold the basic rule. and frankly, I think I would be inclined to uphold it even if I wasn't bound by an oath to do so. Nobody alive in the United States of America today was involved in drafting the Constitution. It is not untypical, even of the most democratic and liberal societies, that people live with an inherited constitution, which they can see evolve with time, whether by judicial decision, whether by amendment, or even by the redrafting of a new constitution. Kenya, for example, came up with a transformative constitution to, in fact, rewrite the political and the socioeconomic landscape of its society. But maybe the most practical thing is to achieve democracy under the constitution that you have, doing so by constitutional means. Because if you step out of the constitutional means to attain your objectives, other people could step out of the constitutional means to attain their counter-objectives. And under a constitution which is unwritten, then there's a higher degree of flexibility. But the trend is towards a written constitution. I mean, in Britain, you move from the king to the king in parliament. There you have your parliamentary supremacy, but the power, it said, of the British Prime Minister is almost unlimited. What is enacted by Parliament is ipso facto law and constitutional, so it was thought. And therefore you then have to now consider a form of constitutional supremacy. So constitutions are forever evolving. And I think that there is much that can be done under the basic law. And I myself believe in it. But since the basic law is full of rights and freedoms, I would listen to any views to the contrary with respect. And there, that's all that I can say. Thank you.
Any remarks from Professor Chen?
I agree entirely with what Cammy said. And if we want to test that proposition, now why do we want to tear up the basic law? Now there's a very vague notion of self-determination, which has never been clearly articulated. But if one takes the argument that simply because we are not part of it, we are not involved in the drafting of the basic law, therefore we have a right to renegotiate it. Now how far that argument can take you to? There are about 1,000 pieces of ordinances in Hong Kong, and leaving aside the private bill, there would be about 600 public ordinances. 500 of them were enacted well before this generation was born. Could we take the same argument, let's scrap all the law? And yes, it is possible, but you have to have a very strong and convincing reason to do it. And if the answer is we want to scrap the law because we don't like it, because it stands in the way of what we want, that reminds me of the scene in A Man for All Seasons, when Henry VIII wants to cut away the divorce law so that he can remarry. Sir Thomas More object as the Lord Chancellor, he object to it. And there was one part of the conversation and where Henry VIII or one of his followers said that if the law of England is like the forest, I will cut to the very last tree. And Sir Thomas More replied, yes, and you are the right man to do, but if you are going to cut until the last tree, and then the devils turn around you, where are you going to hide yourself? I pose the same questions to those who are thinking about that line.
Thank you very much, Professor Chen and Justice Bokhary. And here concludes the event tonight. And I hope all of you will have a better view on which direction the law of Hong Kong is moving, as well as how we're going to progress in terms of our democracy. And we'd like to remind all the audience that we're going to have another session, which is titled as The English Common Law in the Chinese Setting, by the Honorary Mr. Justice Patrick Chan at 6:30 on 11th of November. At the same venue. I think it's a Remembrance Day that day. Yes, 11th of November. So I hope to see you all on that occasion. I wish you all good health and good night. Thank you very much.